Hi, I'm Diva from Musical Hell, and I know the score. So, if you haven't figured out by now that Beauty and the Beast is one of my all-time favorite movies, then hi, welcome to my channel. Glad you could join us. Subscribe button is on the lower left. As the crowning achievement of the 90s Renaissance and one of the most accoladed animated features of all time, it's perhaps not surprising that Disney keeps coming back to this movie. It was the first of their films to be adapted for Broadway, and it has the usual array of direct-to-video sequels, spin-offs, and whatever this is. And I suppose it was probably inevitable that it would eventually be included in Disney's current round of live-action retoolings, a prospect that I've been anticipating, even though I can't help but think it's a bit unnecessary. The animated original is simply perfection, and trying to capture that lightning in a bottle a second time can't help but carry a note of futility. But try they did, and in doing so created another variation on the original soundtrack by Alan Menken and Howard Ashman. So, now is a good time to discuss the evolution of the Beauty and the Beast score through its various adaptations, and how the changes contribute to the tale as old as time. The peculiar thing about Beauty and the Beast is that when you break it down to its essential components, it really doesn't stray too far from the standard Disney fairy tale formula. And that's true of Menken and Ashman's score as well. You have the upbeat opening number, the heroine's I Want song, the villain song, the big production number, and of course the Oscar-ready love ballad. But those components are done so well and complement each other so brilliantly that it creates an extraordinary synergy. It's no wonder that this material eventually went to Broadway, because there's always been something essentially theatrical about it. Belle, for example, has a strong narrative quality as it introduces the setting, the heroine, the antagonist, and some of the central conflicts. It establishes the groundwork for the story to come in a traditional music theater fashion.
There must be more than this provincial life.
Just watch, I'm going to make Belle my wife.
Something there is also very theatrical in the way it uses music to express the character's inner feelings. In the movie, this is done in voiceover, but it still has the elements of an aside or soliloquy.
New and a bit alarming. Who'd have ever thought that this could be true? Charming, but there's something in him that I simply didn't see.
The underscore also has an amazing grandeur to it. The prologue contrasts an ominous bass tremolo with a shimmering bell-like version of the main motif, creating an interplay of light and shadow that immediately brings a richness to the film.
The prince tried to apologize, but it was too late, for she had seen that there was no love in his heart. And as punishment, she transformed him into a hideous beast and placed a powerful spell on the castle and all who lived there.
But as grand as it is, six songs and two reprises isn't enough to sustain a two-act stage production or a two-hour and ten-minute movie. So it's no surprise that Menken, now working with Tim Rice after Ashman's tragically early death, expanded the score for Broadway, or that they expanded it again for the live-action version. After all, there is that Best Original Song nomination to consider. What is interesting is that both expansions parallel each other in the way they develop aspects of the plot that, while not neglected in the original, do deserve a little more attention in a longer adaptation. The first of these is Belle's relationship with her father Maurice. This is a very important plot point because it is the catalyst for the main thrust of the story. The stage version gives us No Matter What, and it's one of my favorite songs in that adaptation. It really emphasizes the depth of the characters' feelings for each other.
You're never strange.
Don't ever change.
Does a Moment Last Forever doesn't quite capture the same strength of tenderness. It's a sweet little music box piece, but the lyrics are rather generalized and don't give the same effect. The song is more effective when it's revisited later in the movie, though.
Sometimes our happiness is captured. Somehow a time and place stands still. Love lives on inside our hearts and always will.
The second aspect that gets explored more in depth is the enchanted objects. But Diva, I hear you yelling at your screen right now, they sing in the original. In fact, they have the two biggest songs in the entire film. Yes, but these songs are not about them as characters. Beauty and the Beast is, well, just what it says on the tin, and Be Our Guest is a show performed for Belle's benefit, so the emphasis is really on her and how they're trying to make her feel. This is an element Menken and Ashman did initially explore with Human Again, which was cut from the animated film, put back in for the stage version, and then added as a bonus scene for the 20th anniversary release. While its placement in the animated movie is rather awkward, I do have a lingering fondness for this number and the way it allows the comic relief to give voice to their motivations. But while Human Again looks forward to a curse-free future, Days in the Sun looks back to happier times before the enchantment. As a result, it has a much more melancholic tone. It's not as catchy, but it is beautiful. And hey, Audra McDonald, how can you say no to that?
Oh, I could sing of the pain these dark days bring.
Finally, there's the Beast himself. For a character who is one of the two primary protagonists and who has the most dramatic character arc, he doesn't sing much in the original movie apart from a few lines in Something There. So naturally, in the expanded versions, he's given a key solo to emphasize his development. In the stage version, it's If I Can't Love Her, which closes out the first act and is appropriately grand and dramatic for that position. Evermore, meanwhile, acts as a lead-in to the film's climax, and so emphasizes the conclusion of the Beast's development rather than the progress. I really like the way these two songs almost complement each other, not only musically, but thematically. Together, they create a great character arc. If Disney ever stages a Broadway revival of this property, I can see this being a worthwhile addition to the score.
I was the one who had it all. I was the master of my fate. I never needed anybody in my life. I learned the truth too late.
Although it never really emerges from the shadow of the animated classic, the new Beauty and the Beast movie has plenty going for it. It's visually stunning, and if the voice cast is uneven, ranging from Emma Watson's serviceable but noticeably overproduced vocals to Audra McDonald, who is, well, Audra fucking McDonald, the staging of the songs is solid and frequently energizing. If it's a little rough around the edges, it does have a good heart. I'm Diva. I know the score, and now, so do you.